this evening. We're grateful for your favor. We're grateful for your kindness. We're grateful for your grace. Thank you because we are here living and existing before your face. Thank you, Jesus, because your eyes are always on us. We thank you, Father, for your many, many blessings that we have received and that we have enjoyed. We give you the praise. This evening, Father, as we discuss your word, much more than our discourse, Lord, your power will be manifested in the name of Jesus. Your glory will be revealed in the name of Jesus. The sick will be healed in the name of Jesus. The deaf will hear clearly in the name of Jesus. If anyone comes here lame, they will walk in the name of Jesus. As a witness to the gospel, we thank you, Father. We exalt your holy name. We pray for our brethren who are writing exams and those who are coming from places, Lord, you will bring them safely in the name of Jesus. Satan will not hinder any one of them in the name of Jesus. Take my voice, O Lord, and let me speak only the things that you once said. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Technica, can you up this thing so I don't stress myself? I think all the sound is going to the front. There's no feedback coming here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Please let us come and move to the front. If you don't have anything doing at the back, please join us in front. You know we are very many today. Hallelujah. We know that others will be joining us as we continue. I want to appreciate God for this opportunity and thank God for Pastor and Mommy. I'm sure are listening to us from the UK, and I know they are going to be back soon. Hallelujah. I thank them for this opportunity. I appreciate Pastor Bello. I know he will join us here very soon. And I thank all those that have come before me. They have made my work easy. Thank you, Father Ogi. Thank you to Pastor Joshua. Pastor Jayola has not arrived. Pastor Felix, Pastor Wally, I know you're listening to us. Thank you so much. The Lord bless you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Technica, please still work on this feedback. Hallelujah. This evening, I'm going to be, so to speak, picking up from where Pastor Ogi stopped. Hallelujah. And like Pastor Bilu said on Sunday, it was as if in the past 2 weeks something, you know, was sparked up, and I have every bit of conviction within me that God wants us to still dig this well on the subject of grace. Hallelujah. And if there's an emphasis, means that there's something that God wants to do, and it will be good for us to stay within. I appreciate how that we're able to go as practical as possible during the last 2 weeks in some of the things. Maybe I'll quickly do a recap of some of the things, just in a bit, some of the things Pastor Gidon said that I'll be trying to build on about grace being the ability to live out or manifest the life of God. I don't know if I'm correct. Am I correct with my notes? Hallelujah. Daddy, you're welcome, sir. Mommy, come on. One profound thing he talked about was the fact that we needed more and more. We needed, you know, abundance of grace. Plenty. There's no limit to, Pastor Jayola, you're welcome, sir. There's no limit to our asking for grace in its abundance. Hallelujah. Because that is what we need. Praise the Lord. And I think last week he talked about some, I refer to them, me, as channels of grace, like pipes or pathways by which grace is ministered to us. And he talked about humility, he talked about faithfulness, being thankful, having a good perspective of God, among other things. Hallelujah. This evening, I just want to take it practically in another way. Not another way, just still within the same stream. I want to look at grace as a substance, or will I call it the substance of grace? Because some of these concepts in the scripture, if God opens our eyes, we'll realize that all concepts in God are substance. They are substantive. That is, they can be, you know, there's a way you can look at faith and say faith just exists in the realm of the mind. You know, just believe. Hallelujah. Just believe. Just hang on. It's abstract. But thank God for Hebrews 12 that says that faith is actually what? The substance of things hoped for. These are truths that we can lay our hands on. We can lay our hands on as we advance, as we go. You understand that you hope for things, but faith is that evidence of that thing. You have not yet seen it, but faith is the evidence of that thing that you are holding on to. Hallelujah. And you know, it's such a concept can be misunderstood, and its knowledge can be abused. We have seen people abuse it because for them, it's only in the realm of the mind. It's only in the realm of their emotions. They just believe that faith is just hang on. Hallelujah. Just what? Some people have even confused it with positive thinking. I hope you know there was a time positive thinking was encroaching the body of Christ. When certain books like Tough Times Don't Last, but Tough People Do, books of all these Zig Ziglar and all these people began to, you know, think and grow rich, positive. And you know, before we knew it, those things were substituting the gospel. People could not separate between faith and those kind of, you know, thought patterns. Hallelujah. I see that the same can be said of grace too. Everybody says it's the grace of God. Even a Yahoo boy can tell you, we na God. We na the grace of God. You know, there are people who believe that every opportunity you get to make it or do well, it is who? Say it's the grace of God. And I think that is where that definition came, that grace is unmerited favor. And I think people must have got that thing from the Amplified Version. I think the Amplified Version always interpreted grace as unmerited favor, which is not totally out of it. Hallelujah. You know, you can say things one way and people, all they are looking at is their next car, their next house. How somebody will just call them and give them something to them. That is what grace means. Hallelujah. So our understanding of grace, to see that this thing is not an abstract. Thank you.
words you can weave together.
Hallelujah. It's not about how much words you can weave together. It is a knowledge that somebody who has never had English before in his life can dispense if God gives him access. Hallelujah. So, receiving grace is simple. Getting access to God. That was what happened to Peter. They just opened one thing and Peter saw and said, "You are the Christ. You are the Christ." Today, we play around with this thing. You know, to us, it's no longer a revelation. But that thing is the reason why you and I are here. I hope you know. That thing is still revelation. It's still what we are unraveling today. His sonship. Hallelujah. That we are also supposed to come into. Are we together? That thing is still serious revelation. It's still giving us problem. Some people have taken it. They have scattered their lives. Just because of this small thing. But Jesus said that flesh and blood, because this knowledge does not exist in the realm of men. That is the epicenter of what you call receiving grace. Because when you look at what happened to Peter's life, immediately after this revelation came to him, we saw that his life took a different turn all the way. I'm saying this evening because if you are going to ask for it says we are receiving grace. We are receiving abundance of grace. We also have to ask for abundance of revelation. That was one of the things that characterized the life of Paul. So much that God had to put one guy there to buffet him so that he will not so that he will not rise like yeast above what he is. Hallelujah. We must understand that if you are talking about abundance of grace, then we must talk about what? Abundance of revelation. Serious ones. Hallelujah. I like the way Strong's define that word grace, which is charis. He says it is the influence. He says it is divine influence upon the heart and its reflection in that particular life. Hallelujah. I think that is, for me, is better than unmerited favor. It's more expansive. It is the influence, it is divine influence upon where? Upon the heart. And that thing can only come as we see. I think Father Ogi taught in the line of sight and hearing. We came by hearing, but the only way we are going to advance is by what? By seeing. I think we should just find a way to go back, pick up that message again, and listen. Because as we see, grace is ministered. Those of us that are in education, we know that the things you see, you retain more than even the things you hear. Even though I heard recently that the last part of your body that dies is the ear. I've never known that. I heard that just 2 weeks ago from a student of nursing. She was telling her in the lab that the last part of the body that dies is the ear. That is why somebody who is in coma and cannot respond to you, he said, but when you call his name, he can hear from a distance, but he may not be able to respond. Yeah, they said the ear does not die easily. No wonder Jesus will call out their names and say, Lazarus, do what? Otiku no yeti etiku. Hallelujah. But you saw that when he raised the dead, he was not laying hands. He was doing what? He was speaking. Lazarus, the daughter of Jairus. I think the only different one was that widow's son where Jesus touched the coffin and then the boy came back to life. Hallelujah. So what am I saying? That we need abundance of revelation. It means that there's a transformation between knowledge and grace. The more you know, the more the grace you receive. That's the only way. That's the way. Hallelujah. So we have established that a man can hang around the Christ and not even know. The same happened in John chapter 21, verse 4 to verse 7. Jesus appeared by the bank of that river, the river Tiberias or what? And then he was there, and his disciples that were with him, they ate together, they moved together, they did things together, could not recognize him. Hallelujah. And that is the undoing of every natural carnal man. That is his undoing. For every Christian that also wants to remain carnal and stay carnal, listen to me, that is your undoing. That's your undoing. If you want to remain that way, then get ready not to receive supply. Because the only way you can receive supply is when you see the person behind that veil. There's a veil they have to remove. Hallelujah. And that is why we go fasting. That's why we go fasting, we go praying, so that certain things can crash. And then the one that is the real thing can what? Can stay. That is why we go fasting. It's not because without praying, without fasting, God won't hear you. He does. But there are times when we need that certain words, they do what? They come down. We know times when we see better. Praise God. And when we say grace, please, I am talking about the grace of God in the entirety of it. Like we have once had in this church, that the grace you need for the patience you need for marriage is not different from the patience you need to have with your fellow brother here. Praise God. Hallelujah. It's only the intensity that is different. Are we together? We agree that patience is patience. Hello, are we agreeing that patience is what? Patience. Hallelujah. It's just that my prayer for you is you not marry a woman who is nagging, because you are going to need plenty of it. Solomon said that it is better to live in the attic than to live with a nagging woman. Hallelujah. Or with a nagging man. Because some men can nag too. Hallelujah. So is grace. So I'm talking about grace, the grace of God in all of his forms. When we see God at work in the life of a man, it may be an anointing, it may be an aptitude to, you know, in Christian service, an anointing, a grace, can be a gift of the Spirit and all that. What do we still call it? We say there's a grace of God upon where? Upon the life of that man. So I'm talking about grace in all of its entirety. Hallelujah. Because God will minister it to you.
There are many things that will not come to you. And watch it, check it. Some of the things that become proficient in Christ Jesus is because the revelation of those things has come to you. It's possible for you to know the revelation of healing. Yeah? You know it beforehand, you know it inside out. Hallelujah. It is very what? It is very possible that you can take. God can help. Journey so much that there's a gift of the Holy Ghost that God can help you to understand how to go back. While people are still, you know, those days when people say, and God spoke to me, God, well, and my wife will listen to one message and wake up. And if I said those days, people say, God spoke to me, God spoke to me. They are always wondering, why is God not speaking? There are people here who really don't understand how God speaks to people. I won't ask you to raise your hand. I am telling you now that God speaks to you, and that you can enjoy the grace of God in that regard. Hallelujah. So the grace of God is a supply. It's an access God gives to you into his things. And then how he gives to you is that he opens your eyes to see. Because you have been born. Praise God. He says, except a man is born of the water and the spirit, he cannot what? He cannot enter me. If you are not born again, you cannot what? You cannot see. The truth is that you have been born. So just like we had that some people became sinners, not because they sinned, but because they inherited sin. And after they inherited it, they continued to what? Jesus say? Let's go back to that Matthew chapter 16. See, we need to, so that we will not just be talking grace in abstract. You need God to open your eyes so that you will see. Let's go to Matthew chapter 16, that place where we went. Because when that revelation was showed to Peter, something happened to his life. Jesus prayed. Let's go to that verse. That's in verse 13. Let's go to say 16. What is 16? Okay, 17. 18. So after Jesus said, this is not come by flesh and blood. This one didn't come by flesh and blood. This one came by revelation. Hallelujah. For some of us who have a little inclination in the prophetic, it's somehow that we just know certain things. They ask you, how do you know it? I don't know. I just know. There's no history to. And it's one of the ways that applies to me, may not apply to you. Some of the ways I know God has spoken to me somewhere, he dropped the thoughts. And I think. Circumference around me, I look what brought me to this point. You know, there's a way you can trace your thoughts. Maybe suddenly I just think about suddenly, and then I can think back that okay, my wife had discussed with her, we had called on phone, and we are spoken. That one I will need to probe further. If God is really speaking to me, I will need some other checks here and there to know. But there are times when the knowledge just drops. Somebody who is in Faraway, United States. I don't have any business thinking about it. There's no reason why I should. Hallelujah. Sometimes I think about somebody, and he just draws somebody I've not had contact with in the last 5 years. The Holy Ghost just draws. So I think, I say, how did I get here? I have no reason to know. Sometimes I just know that when I follow him by me, so long by me. Praise God. There are things you just know. And you just know. How you know it, you don't know. It's like something just broke. Have you ever been at it? Did you ever know the time you recovered from your malaria? Has it happened to you? You knew the very season you began to recover from your malaria. That's happened to me before. You just sweat. As the sweat is breaking, you just begin to realize that thing that was happening to you began to. It was like you broke out of one state into what? The other state. Has it happened to you before? You knew when you actually began to get away. That's happened before. Sometimes revelation is like that. It's close. And sometimes it is coming the way I'm talking to you like this. Hallelujah. Like the message you were listening to now, when the man said, not every word that the preacher is saying is the word. See, when your own comes, you know it. What comes? Malaria was always my big problem. You see, at some point I almost did not believe taking confession. But at some point I realized that I began to work. Want to work. Praise God. Don't worry, if it's not working for you, it will work. In the name of Jesus. Which who came from somewhere to here. And where you are seeing us today, we are still going somewhere. Hallelujah. All you need to do is just to cooperate. That's all you have to do. So what happened to him? Verse 18. And I say also unto thee, because every time you receive revelation like this, there's a relevant place on your life. So I say unto thee that one, Peter, I'm upon this rock. We have said it, Peter is not the rock. Check the meaning of Means mass of rock. So they are different. So that rock. Peter was, is it not interesting that Jesus used rock and rock? Jesus named him rock and said, on this rock, even though he was talking about two different kinds of rock, but this was not a coincidence. That means that that revelation he received confirmed something of him. Hello? Are we together? He confirmed something on him, because Jesus was talking about the rock upon which was going to build his church, which was that revelation that he brought, that God, that the Father revealed to him, and then Jesus named him, that you are Petrus.
Let's go to the next verse, 17. 19, sorry. And I will do what? I will do what? Jesus was talking to Peter directly. He said, I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Is there anything after that in verse 20? I think another story began in verse 20. So let us, then he charged them that he should tell no man that it was Jesus the Christ. If you read further, he began to manifest something else, but let us forgive him this evening and not get to that story. I'm interested in this first one. That there was a revelation that God showed to him, even though I didn't know if he understood what he said at all. That's why I said this knowledge that we are talking about has nothing to do with your cerebral anything. Fine. That's why we read scripture. The reason you read scripture is so that the revelation can find somewhere to rest. Praise God. Because when you are empty, revelation can be difficult to get. And you know, those men had been listening to the words of Jesus also. Because faith comes by what? By hearing and hearing. That's why you are encouraged to engage and interact with the Bible. But here, Jesus then conferred something upon him. There was a relevance that came upon his life from that. Even though Jesus never did any official announcement that Peter, you are the leader of this apostolic team, supernaturally, he just became. You can trace everything to this place. Hallelujah. This was a turning point, because there was really nothing special with him. The way he came was the way, I think it was even his brother Andrew that called him. Abby? You know, different episodes. One of the gospels said they were in the fishing something. But I know that some of those stories, one story led to another story. Everybody wrote, the side of the story that they had. Hallelujah. It's possible that sometimes their first encounter with Jesus was not, maybe it wasn't that fishing encounter. Maybe this had come. I think Watchmani wrote a book like that about how to piece the gospels together. And I'm looking for that book. I don't know the title of the book. I just saw it. I don't know. If you know the book, please help me. He wrote about how the four gospels, how you can interpret the four gospels. Because some of the people that are atheists, this is one of the things Satan is using against them. That the accounts of the gospels are not... Satan is really using it to deceive people. Hallelujah. So he became relevant in the agenda of God. So much that when Jesus said, I prayed for you, Jesus told him, when you are converted, you should do what? You should strengthen your brothers. That is what revelation can do. But apart from the fact that you become relevant with God, you also become a target for Satan. As a matter of fact, any time you begin to suffer attacks, it can be a point of the fact that God just released grace to you. Just suddenly discovered that things began to go the other way around. Of all of them, apart from Judas, who we knew had his own character problems, he was a thief. Hallelujah. This one, Satan desired this one. Hallelujah. I'm telling you what divine revelation, what pedestal he can place you in the spirit if God gives it to you. Amen. If God gives it to you, if you continue and the Lord, and you continue with the Lord, and God continues to open your eyes, and you continue being, shown things, and you are knowing things, and the knowledge of the Christ, you are growing in it, and going, you come to a pedestal in the spirit where you can become a target for Satan. It's one of the ways to even test. So many times as a child of God, when you find out that suddenly it's like every hell is breaking loose, it's like something is just after you, it's like business is not working, it's like something just happened along the line. Hey, it can be an indication that you just got promoted. It can be an indication that you just got promoted, and Satan knows that this thing that is with this man is I can't stand it. It's a serious problem. It's going to be a serious problem for me. He begins to cause all kinds of things. We are going to see scripture. What happened to Joseph? Not be dream, he dream. Hallelujah. I hope you know that Joseph's dream was not just the dream of just his destiny alone. That dream was a dream that those things were things that were pointing to his eternal purpose. But when you look at him, he was the one through him, the word that God told Abraham. How many years ago? You know, it was through him that God took them to Egypt. And then he preserved Israel. Along the line, we saw another Joseph come in the Gospels who played out exactly the same thing. Took God's son to Egypt. Eh? And brought him back. Hallelujah. Preserving the life of the Son of God. After that, we saw another Joseph. Hope you remember Arimathea. Came again. What did he preserve? Took the body. All of them fulfilling scripture. Fulfilling scripture. Hallelujah. Says they buried him in the tomb of the rich and all that. And he preserved that body. So when he was seeing those dreams, our own problem is that when they talk to you about your future, about your destiny, you are quick to think about your future in this world. That's the wahala. It's one of the issues God has with us.
The first thing we are thinking is, look at it. After you have made all the money here, what will happen? We are not supposed to be thinking like people of this place. We must be thinking, maybe that's why many things are not coming to us in the spirit. Because I'm not thinking around how you are going to build a bigger house. Are you going to? You have helped God. All the money God wants to give to give to the gospel, you have helped God to plan how you will spend it. Shows up, and he wants to fight it.
I employ Bobokan, you'll be helping me to keep you in check. Hallelujah. The man went to pray. First time, second time, third time, God said, give me one day. Uri of Femi, Yoshikini, two four. Hallelujah. That's what it means, that grace what? Grace teaches. Teaches. And that's why we should fear more inside grace. Because they gave it to you when you were nobody. You know, Job said something in a very brief revelation about God. He said he gives and he takes away. That's how God does. In the world, before I can be sure that I want to give you, I must first confirm that you are a good person. Abi, when you go for job interviews, what do you think they are trying to confirm? Hello? They're trying to confirm what? Whether we can say you choke, you say criminal. Say you don't have police. Yes. You don't have all those things. But you know, this grace, when Jesus brought it, he died for us when we were still what? Sinners. If it told this sin here, that's why we should fear. He gave it to us when we were nobody. We were sinners. So many times, God does not first take your sin away and give you grace. He gives you grace. Then he does what? He takes away your sin. Hallelujah. How did you know that you were a sinner? Was it not that grace appeared to you? Hallelujah. So, how many minutes do I have? Is the timer working? You can't see it. So this knowledge we are talking about, only God can release it. Flesh and blood cannot get it out. Only him releases it. I told you about somebody who said he wanted to go and fast and pray. What does he love? Lucifer. He got tired and came back. Because this thing does not respond to your efforts. Is it that you will not now do anything? No. Whatever you are doing should be out of obedience, out of the fact that this is from one level of grace to another. You have found grace to be able to what? Find what? Grace. That's the way it works. If you have not found that grace, you can try. You can try. You're on it. That's why certain things have not worked. And I'm praying for you this evening that you will begin to walk in the name of the Lord Jesus. 6 minutes, okay? I'm trying to close up. Whatever I cannot get, continue with it next week. Hallelujah. So, I'm going to be heading on this note this evening that grace places the responsibility on us. As it confers relevance, it also places a responsibility on us. And it also makes us targets for the enemy. Satan wanted to have Peter because he knew that among the 12 he had something that others necessarily did not have. Despite his weakness in the way he talks, despite all of his weaknesses, even Jesus could not afford to lose him. Jesus said, I have prayed for you. It makes you relevant in God's plan, in God's agenda. And at the same time, Satan comes around. If you read the account of Peter and James, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6. You see something there? Humble yourselves, therefore, not in my sight of God, and be exalted you were in the place. What is it? What do you think this exaltation is? It's grace. At least, what did the previous verse say? Talk about God gives grace today. Okay? It's like one of the younger submit yourself to the elder, ye, all of you, be sorry one to another, and be clothed with what? Humility. For God, what? And give it to us. So when we now go to verse 6. Now say, you should now humble yourself, one of the presence of God, that he may exalt you in due time. For me, and define this grace. Alright? Verse 7. Cast not your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Verse 8. So, Babi, we do next say they are talking about.
promises that God will open our eyes. In the name of Jesus. We'll talk about the vehicles by which revelation comes. Because there are many ways. Many ways by which revelation can come. I'm sure to you, Christ, we saw even Christ. How he was helped, you know, in the Gospels. We're going to look at some of these things. We're going to look at you. I'm saying all of this because you should be able to handle grace. God will help you. God will help me. Be able to handle grace. We will understand the dynamics of these things. They put it in the Bible there for us to see and to read. Hallelujah. Have you met people who bastardize, you know, the teaching on having a relationship with the Holy Spirit and then decided asking the Holy Spirit, what fruit should I wear? Holy Spirit, what shirt should I wear? And I think I told somebody one day, I said, if they ask this people that they should brush their teeth. You know? Am I saying the Holy Spirit cannot tell you wear this, don't wear that? But because they said that they can have a relationship with the Holy Spirit and then they began to ask all those kind of things that will lead you into, you know, and every morning you wake up, you ask Holy Spirit, what should I do today? What should I? What should I? What should I? They gave you a prayer to be able to think out those things. Hallelujah. If the Holy Spirit needs to intercept you and interject, he will. If there is a need, are we together? That is how much somebody taught them so. That's why this issue of grace too, we must grasp it very, very well. So that was it in June 24. Let's read that as I go. That some people took the grace of God for lasciviousness. Hallelujah. As an opportunity to do all kinds of things. Because they really do not understand what they say, but there are certain men crept on our way as well before God ordained to this condemnation. Ungodly men, but in the grace of God, into what? Lasciviousness and what? And denying the only Lord God and our Lord, what? Jesus Christ. We're going to ask for abundance of revelation. We're going to ask for it. You know how? There's no other way. Our eyes must open. That is the way the New Testament is designed. Hallelujah. Even in the Old, God introduced himself to people by different. Look at Moses introduced himself as something. All those things were God giving himself out, revealing himself. And in God revealing himself to a man, and in the strength of that revelation, the man go and conquer nations. Do you understand? Then we told Gideon, this is, you know, just showed him, because even an angel that appeared to him, opened his eyes to it, and with that Gideon went and what? And conquered. Gave Moses just a piece of him and says, I am that I am. That he don't even understand. And by the strength of that, he went and countered Pharaoh. Hallelujah. It's revelation, no? Revelation, and we have to read Ephesians 1 very, 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 very well. Very, very well. That God will work